Outer Wilds is a game about curiosity. It places you into a constantly moving, constantly changing solar system, a tiny thread in an enormous tapestry, then gives you a kick and leaves you spinning into the void to simply pick a direction and explore.
No, 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 no. I hate this, 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 I hate this. Oh, fuck you, autopilot.
When starting out, the world of Outer Wilds is a dangerous and terrifying one. Death is not only easy, but expected. Every 22 minutes, the sun explodes and the slate is wiped clean, ready for another go-around. That's assuming you haven't already been crushed, burned, eaten, suffocated, drowned, eaten again, blown up, or... Okay, that one was actually my fault. And because of that constant resetting of the board, that danger quickly becomes a challenge rather than a deterrent. It encourages experimentation, a pushing of boundaries. Why not jump into that sand geyser? Why not see what's inside that volcanic moon? Why not try and sneak past that anglerfish nest? The worst that can happen is... And then you're right back to the start. New knowledge gained, ready to try again, or fly somewhere new. There'll always be something else to explore. Spectacle and wonder make up the backbone of Outer Wilds' visuals. Every planet has its own unique, beautiful aesthetic and accompanying gameplay challenges. From the shifting sands of the Hourglass Twins to the fierce storms of Giant's Deep to the of Dark Bramble, and each one has layers to uncover as you start to pick apart its mechanisms. And as the player delves deeper into them, the feeling of isolation, of exploring the unknown, grows in tandem. Take Giant's Deep, my personal favourite. At its surface, a swirling maelstrom of waterspouts and shattered ruins, a constant flux of motion that evokes the awe and terror of real-life natural disasters. But then you explore elsewhere and learn the secret of its twisters to find your way under the shifting currents. There's a sudden serenity, a loneliness. The pounding of the storm above is muffled, and you're left there with only the calm, indifferent native life for company. Then you learn more, and return again, and this time penetrate even further, below the electric core. Everything is silent. You're stripped of your ship, your torch barely permeates the blackness. It's haunting. I've always been fascinated with the deep sea. And the first time I made it here, I felt myself regressing to my childhood, obsessing over videos of dark trenches and alien creatures dwelling within. I felt totally alone. Outer Wilds is not a game about conquering nature so much as figuring out your role in it. You don't unlock new abilities that let you freely ignore its perils, no anglerfish repellent or insulated suit. The world is just as deadly on your first loop as your 50th. Instead, you learn to work within the boundaries the game sets out for you. You get better at navigating, at predicting, at timing. And as you do so, as you start to see yourself more and more as a tiny part of an enormous machine, you start to realize how much you're following the paths of those that came before. You see... Wait, I'm not done yet. Outer Wilds is a game about history. The original alpha version of the game was already winning prizes in 2015, but it still needed a story, a hook to tie everything together, something to drive the player forward and keep that curiosity burning. A time loop conceit makes it hard to have the player believably make permanent impacts on the game world, so instead, another axis was added. The game became about exploration in time as well as space. And so the Nomai were born, and then killed off. In the arms of the angel. Despite not being a living presence, the Nomai are the beating heart of Outer Wilds. Through their writings, the player pieces together their projects, intentions, the great works they built. The game very cleverly uses a variety of communication methods for different gameplay purposes. For instance, these scrolls and accompanying walls catch the eye and make sure the player fully investigates the areas they find themselves in. These two-way communicators work to link the planets and their various projects together, and the viewing platforms provide previews and nudge the player into what areas to look out for. And these wall scrolls help lead the player down tunnels, through ruins and into hidden areas. Despite being the same layout as the other two, having them graffitied like this instead feels more naturalistic, and the writings they contain are often more casual. Hold on to that, that'll be important later. And as we learn about their projects, we learn vicariously about the Nomai themselves. It's repeatedly emphasized that they were a curious people, and their excitement and enthusiasm for science, for testing and experimenting, all reflects back on us as the player, encourages us to follow in their footsteps. Their curiosity led them to our solar system, led them to explore and tinker and build. The Hanging City on Brittle Hollow, the Sunless City on Ember Twin, the workshops of Giant's Deep, it all gives us insights into how they lived. We find not just labs and forges, but schools, shrines, places where children played. It feels like a real civilization. And the Nomai were a kind people. You can find notes on Timber Hearth, your home, of the Nomai ensuring that they leave enough resources for any future civilizations. And there's a wonderful moment when you're exploring the underground rivers beneath the surface, where you can stumble across a recording of a diver excitedly finding a newly evolving species. Your race's precursor. And so, many years on, and thanks to the Nomai, the Hearthians took to the skies. Outer Wilds is a game about trying to fly to the sun station, misjudging your speed of approach, and dying a fiery death over and over and over and over and over and over and over. No, that one doesn't count. Outer Wilds is a game about community. When you start the game, the first thing you see is the endless expanse of space. A flash of blue lightning as something explodes in orbit around Giant's Deep. It's unknown and exciting and scary. Then your eyes look down and you're greeted with a warm campfire and a friendly face. You're invited to stay, roast marshmallows, relax for a bit. Then you're sent into the nearby village, a disguised tutorial area. You learn the history of those that came before you, play hide and seek with a couple of kids, fly a model ship, help with a few simple repairs. And while all these mini-games teach the player the ropes of their upcoming adventure, they also instill a sense of excitement. In an interview with NoClip, developer Alex Beecham mentioned how initial versions of the starting village had the player character as a lone pioneer, eager to explore the reaches of space in defiance of the worries and dissuasions of their peers. But as it turned out, this had the opposite effect. The desire to be a rebel wasn't there. Humans are social creatures, and even a simple, half-built virtual society was enough to make the player want to fit in and stay on solid ground. So instead, the developers introduced the space program. In Beecham's own words,
"It's a bit quirky, but we're going to get you excited about space by having everyone else on some level be excited about space." The last version
of the... Just as the Nomai's penchant for discovery encourages the player to push boundaries and experiment, so too does the village encourage the player to broaden their horizons. When talking with Hornfels after collecting the launch codes from them, they ask the player what they plan to do, and a huge list of options opens up. These were put in, as Beecham says, to give the player a few different nudges, ideas for things to try, but also emphasize that it really is their choice to go anywhere they like. Then, once you do head up, you have the traveler camps. These provide areas of safety that the player can fall back on, and just like the Nomai, they act as a reminder that the player is following in the footsteps of those that came before. The characterization of your fellow astronauts is also fantastic, right down to their individual instruments. Gabbro's laissez-faire attitude, Ryback's struggles to balance their fear and curiosity, feldspar. All of them feel, for lack of a better word, human. These oases of calm are necessary to allow the player somewhere to escape and get their bearings, and the friendliness and welcoming nature of their owners stand as a contrast to the uncaring dangers of what surrounds them. To really show how vital they are, though, we need to look at this game's inverse. Let's take a detour. Heaven's Vault is a game about curiosity. It places you into a... Wait, hang on a second. Heaven's Vault, like Outer Wilds, is a game about archaeology and exploration. You play as Alaya, an archaeologist, sailing between various moons, uncovering artifacts and translating an ancient language. There's a bit more linearity in how areas become available, although the story can heavily branch based on your actions and finds, and much more of a focus on dialogue. It's a very, very good game, and one I highly recommend if you're a language nerd. The core of the game is piecing together what feels like a fully realized written conlang from a past civilization, figuring out how different symbols work as thematic signifiers and grammar marks. It's so satisfying. Just for emphasis, you can see here some of my notes and written dictionary that I made while I was playing. What I find fascinating though, playing Heaven's Vault so soon after Outer Wilds, is the contrast in tone between the two games. And I don't just mean that they're different genres, but that they approach a similar set of themes, exploration, archaeology, isolation, in diametrically opposed ways. The world of Heaven's Vault is far less dangerous than Outer Wilds. I'm not sure if it's even possible to die in the game, but it's certainly at least very difficult if so. Travel between moons is straightforward and can be automated, and you spend far more time among people in civilization. Yet, despite that, the world feels more actively hostile. Many of the people you talk to are at best dismissive of your profession and at worst actively belligerent or threatening. A major theme of the game is that Alaya is a person caught between two homes and two upbringings, struggling to be accepted by either, all while following a dream that is at odds with both. The only person who seems to have your full interest at heart is your robot companion, Six, who is nonetheless enough of a nag about safety that a major story beat gives you the option to sell him off to a trader. But I'd never do that. I mean, look at him. Look at that face. In Outer Wilds, other living souls promise moments of respite, of sanctity against the uncaring dangers of space. In Heaven's Vault, other people worry me. I'd start to feel apprehensive whenever I had to return to civilization, and look forward more and more to those moments when I could just eschew the overarching story somewhat and focus on my language studies, when it was just myself, a new site to explore, and an overly worried robot. My point here is not to espouse the superiority of either game over the other, but instead to suggest that it's important for a game to find a balance between feelings of peril and ones of safety. However the danger in your game world comes across, whether natural or personal, there needs to be some form of escape from it, often in the form of that danger's inverse. Isolated exploration, warm community. Isolated community, serene exploration. There's a reason Dark Souls bonfires are such an iconic video game mechanic. While we're here, the way that the two games treat their archaeology is also an interesting reflection of their tone. The work in Heaven's Vault is more in-depth, but more detached. The passages you translate are generally disjointed scraps of longer texts, marks of prayer or words of courage from signs, maps, and murals. Museum pieces. By contrast, Outer Wilds is a game about relationships. There's a piece of ancient graffiti in the Hanging City on Brittle Hollow that's stuck with me ever since I first found it. It's written by Poke, a character whose writings can be found all over the galaxy, and who is definitely one of the smartest members of the entire extinct cast. Having volunteered to take on the task of building a specialized for the Ash Twin project, she's suddenly overcome by feelings of insecurity for her own level of skill, and of sadness for her deceased mentor and friend. She takes some time to ruminate on these feelings, come to terms with them, remind herself of the community that supports her, and prepares to work. As far as actual gameplay goes, it's worth basically nothing. The information it gives you, the creation of a can easily be picked up from multiple other sources, one right outside even. But when I first found it, it resonated with me. Here was a long-dead member of an ancient, galaxy-spanning race, one responsible for works of incredible wonder and beauty, experiencing the same moment of self-doubt that I think every creator feels at some point. Looking back on their predecessors, just as I was looking back on them. Further outside the city, in the original settlement the Nomai made after their escape pod landed on Brittle Hollow, there are areas where the survivors mourned their dead, discussed their losses, and made what plans they could to move on. Again, there's scant info to be found in most of their messages, but that doesn't mean they don't do important work story-wise. The ancient aliens trope is a classic in science fiction. Some long-dead or missing historical precursor that, knowingly or unknowingly, has a part in shaping the present. A fairly common facet to the implementation of this trope, however, is that this ancient race is not only unseen, but impersonal. They, in essence, act as a civilization-spanning MacGuffin, a foundation for the story to jump off from. We see their presence through the technologies they leave behind, or the great ruins or epic tales and myths, but we rarely find out about the individuals that belonged to that era. The strength of Outer Wilds is that it turns this idea on its head. The writing for the Nomai was predominantly done by Kelsey Beecham, Alex's sister, who was responsible for the myriad personal touches in their notes.
I don't think people really connect with like a civilization as a whole. So I think it necessarily had to be very character-driven, which was terrifying.
The Nomai writings aren't just exposition. Thanks to Beecham's writing, they're not just another impersonal ancient aliens trope. They argue and banter and flirt. They celebrate successes, commiserate failures, worry and care for each other, and make terrible puns. Really terrible puns. Something I love reading about is ancient graffiti from places like Pompeii, scribbles on walls that read as though they could have been written today, people wanting to share the mundane aspects of their lives with the world. It's a reminder that archaeology is not always about uncovering beautiful temples and tombs of great rulers. Sometimes it's about finding little reminders that the people of the past weren't abstract silhouettes, but real, flawed, emotional beings. This right here is why Outer Wilds works so well. Why the game is more than just a beautiful sandbox. Why I can say that a game which you primarily spend alone is a game about relationships and community. And here's where I'm going to have to go into full spoiler territory, including the ending. So here's the time to skip to if you want to go straight to the final wrap-up. Okay. Finding Solanum on the Quantum Moon was one of the most affecting moments in a game that I've ever experienced. I actually had to pause, get up, and walk away from the computer for a minute to process what I'd just discovered. I had spent hours following the trail of this ancient civilization, learning how they were thrown here by fate, then grew, explored, experimented. And here was a real-life member of this society. Not just that, but one whose story I could trace from childhood. Through the power of curiosity, research, and sheer recklessness, two histories were joined. Then the sun blew up halfway through our conversation and I had to do it again. So it goes. The Quantum Moon is one of the game's most prominent mysteries, one which requires a great deal of work and exploration to solve. It makes sense then that the reward for navigating it should be such an event. And while technically optional, skipping it means not only missing out on the discovery, but also a key piece of the ending. Not only will Solanum not be present, but her absence reverberates even post-credits. All the players need to come together for the next universe to be at its best. The ending is where the game drops all pretense of realism and dives fully into symbolic territory. It's a brave choice that could have gone horribly wrong, but the reason it succeeds so well is because it fully embraces the themes of community that it's been building up from the beginning. Bringing together your fellow astronauts, who provided moments of respite and cheer throughout your travels, giving them one last chance to play together, and through your combined efforts, beginning anew. After hours of playing to the whims of a cold and dangerous universe, the solution comes in the form of a few intrepid souls making music together. Science fiction is a wide-spanning genre, but to me, one of the best things it can do is explore that balance between the small scale and the great, to both reveal our position as a tiny speck in a vast blackness and still find those vital personal stories within that make us feel like something more. To finish on a quote by Ursula K. Le Guin, science fiction, properly conceived, is a way of trying to describe what is in fact going on, what people actually do and feel, how people relate to everything else in this vast sack, this belly of the universe, this womb of things to be and tomb of things that were, this unending story. In it, as in all fiction, there is room enough to keep even man where he belongs, in his place in the scheme of things. Still, there are seeds to be gathered, and room in the bag of stars.
Oh, come on.